My rather silly job title is Head of Effectiveness at Adam and Eve DDB, which is a London creative agency. So you might wonder what a Head of Effectiveness does. So my job is I measure the effects of advertising and marketing. I work out what sells stuff, and I try to make it sell better. That's what I do. So that's my day job. My day job is about making more money for more of our clients. But I also have a kind of side hustle, which is I work with the IPA, which is the industry body which represents advertising in the UK. And with my colleague Peter Field, the two of us have spent the last 12 years trying to understand what the rules are for making effective advertising. Are there rules, are there principles, are there ingredients that can help you make more money? And we're able to do this because we have access to a fantastic resource, which is the IPA Data Bank, a huge database that they've been collating for over 30 years now, which contains information on about 1,500 advertising and marketing campaigns, with information about the strategies, the budgets, the media, the creative work, but crucially, about what happened to sales, about what happened to market share, about what happened to profit. And we've spent the last 12 years mining this data to try and understand what drives sales and profit. So we published four books over that time, looking at questions like, are there actually any rules for effectiveness? Is it all just random, or are there actual principles that will guide your success? When we first started, we didn't know whether there would be anything statistically significant in the data. I'm a statistician, so I care about things like that. We did find some rules. We did find some clear principles that will help you to make more money, but they're not necessarily the things that everybody thinks. And then in recent years, we've begun to look at how those rules need to be varied and changed and flexed to fit particular brands in particular situations and how they might or might not be changing in the digital age. And that's what I want to talk about today. So I'm going to start by just summarizing really the whole of the four books in two slides. So 12 years worth of work in about 4 minutes, if I do it properly. The fundamental thing that we really try to get across to people is that there are two very different ways that marketing can work. Short-term approaches and long-term approaches. And they require very different tactics and strategies. The short-term approach is easy to understand, and it's really, I think, the dominant approach in marketing today. It's what we call sales activation. This is really the world of direct marketing, performance marketing, promotional marketing, and a lot of digital marketing. In this world, what you do is you focus ruthlessly on selling stuff now. Let's look at the people who are really the hot prospects, the people most likely to respond to our advertising. Let's target them ruthlessly, efficiently, no wastage. And let's give them relevant messages, persuasive messages, maybe give them offers. And let's use media that will make it easy for them to respond, ideally with one click. This is the world of programmatic. This is the world of paid search. This is the world of so much digital marketing. One click, straight through to sales. No wastage. This is what we're aiming at in most marketing today. And when you get that right, the sales effects can be really big, really immediate, and really easy to see. Big, sharp spikes when you turn it on. High ROI, high efficiency, no wastage. But there's a real problem with this stuff, and you can see it in the chart. Yes, when you turn it on, you get a big spike in your sales. But when you turn it off, It just disappears to nothing. There's no carryover. There's no build. There's no long-term benefit. And because there's no long-term benefit, because the decay is so fast, the sales effects don't accumulate. And so there's no long-term growth from this stuff. It's just a treadmill of endless short-term selling. Very efficient, but it's not enough to make a business grow. If you want to make your business grow, you've got to do something else. This is about harvesting demand. This is about triggering demand for your brand that already exists. If you want to grow a business, you've got to create demand. You've got to build preference for your brand. You've got to bring in new customers. And that requires a different approach. That requires brand building. Brand building requires talking to people long before they come to buy. It involves creating perceptions and memories and awareness of the brand. And it crucially involves making sure that those memories last so that when people come to buy, they already prefer your brand and that they keep preferring your brand and they keep coming back to your brand again and again and again. When you do that, the effects are quite different. This kind of brand building is hard to do. It requires talking to people when they're not really interested in what you have to say. It requires creating long-term memories, which is a hard thing to do. But if you get it right, you do get some additional sales right now. So you can see, no, you can't see, but you can see each time that you do a burst of brand building activity, it ratchets up, lifts up the base level of your sales a little bit. And the effects last. They don't decay straight away. And then each subsequent bit of brand building adds more to the base level and more and more. And so you build your sales over time. So that in the long run, brand building is the main driver of growth. And it's also the main driver of profit. And it's particularly profitable because what brand building can do, which nothing else can do, is it reduces price sensitivity. It makes people pay less attention to the price. It makes people more willing to pay high prices. So brand building means more growth, more sales at higher prices, and therefore much more profit. Okay, so in the long run, it's brand building that is the main driver of profit for businesses. And we've looked at this for every consumer category that we could find. We've looked at this for different brands in different situations. Brand building is the main driver of growth and profit for almost every business. But actually, you need both brand building and sales activation working together because each enhances the other. You need to build strong brands, and then you need to trigger those demand for those brands with activation. Build up memories and preference, trigger that, those memories efficiently, and convert them into sales. And when you get that, those two things working together, you get really strong, really powerful, really profitable effects. And what our research has shown in more recent years is there does seem to be an optimum balance between brand building and activation. We call this the 60-40 rule. What we find is that if you look at, on the y-axis of this chart, the overall effectiveness, the overall effect on things like sales and profit for a brand, then it varies according to the mix of brand and activation. On the right hand, you see campaigns that just do brand building and don't activate. That's not efficient. That's not effective. On the left hand, you see campaigns that just do activation but don't do brand building. That's really underperforms. The sweet spot, maximum effectiveness, is about 60% brand building and about 40% activation. So lead with brand, support with activation. Okay, that's the whole of my career in two slides. Okay, thank you. So having spent 12 years doing this stuff, it's really irritating when people get say this. They say, yeah, that was last year. The rules have now changed. Obviously, we live in a changing environment. Technology is changing. Businesses are changing. The economy is changing. And it's reasonable to assume that some of these rules might be changing. In particular, I think I sense, I don't know about you, but I sense that there's a sort of a rhetoric that nowadays you don't really need advertising. Nowadays you don't really need all this wasteful mass marketing. And also that you don't need brand advertising. There's a growing group, I think, of people in business and to some extent marketing that don't believe in brand building anymore, that think it's really that performance marketing is the only kind of marketing that matters. It's all about selling, and that what digital should do is neglect mass marketing, do personalized, highly targeted performance marketing, because that's what sells stuff. So there are a number of arguments that they use to advance for why you don't need brand building anymore. I've heard this referred to recently as the war on brand. You know, let's kill brand building. We don't need that stuff. It's inefficient. So what we've done in our most recent research is to look at some of these issues in particular. I'm going to talk about some of the things that people say. So one of the things that people say is that we live in a time of great innovation, and many of the businesses that are marketing today have radically innovative technology, new disruptive products and services, and those people don't need to advertise, and they don't certainly don't need to do brand building. Well, there's a little bit of truth in this. What we do know is that if you do have a radically innovative product, then actually you can get, in the early days, very good growth, exponential growth even, by simply making it available and allowing it to propagate virally, you know, by word of mouth. And this is how, for example, firms like Uber and Amazon and so forth began their businesses. When Uber didn't advertise when they first arrived in the UK, I don't know about here, but all they did in the UK was they used member get member, some price promotions, and the whole thing just exploded exponentially. But what all these businesses find is that at a certain point, that exponential growth begins to slow down. It looks like an exponential growth at first. In fact, it's an S-shaped curve. And we even know the equation that describes that curve. It's called the Bass diffusion model. So sooner or later, these businesses all find that they need to advertise. Look at Uber. Uber now is advertising in cinema, in press, on radio, in posters, and also on TV. Amazon now advertises very heavily on TV in the UK. And when these innovative products do decide that they need to support their brand with advertising, brand advertising turns out to be absolutely crucial. What we find is that for the average campaign, as I say, the optimum mix is about 60% brand building, 40% activation, 62-38. But for highly innovative companies, they can spend a bit less, but actually they need to tilt towards brand building. They need something more like 70%, 72% brand building, 28% activation. The reason for this is if you've got a highly innovative product, activation is actually very easy. Just, you know, getting people to closing the deal is easy if you've got a great radically different product. What you need to focus on is getting awareness of it and doing the brand building that drives people to find out about it and to buy it. So when innovators do decide to advertise, they need to spend more on brand, not less. And this is a general rule. When activation is easy, when activation works well, you can actually spend a bit less on that. And then brand building is the final frontier. You'll see this in a second. So another argument that people use is, well, you don't need to do brand building now because consumers will find out about your brand themselves. We've got Google, we've got websites, we've got price comparison sites. Everyone can find out about the products and everyone can find out about the specifications and the prices. You don't need to tell people stuff. Yes, that's right, to some extent. But that means you don't need to do so much activation. Activation is the bit where you tell people about products and services and specifications. But what you do need to do is do the brand building that primes people to want your brand before they do the research. So what we find is in categories where people do a lot of research, actually you need to do more brand building, not less. We're talking about more like 75-25 for high research categories. So yes, it's true people can do more research now, but that means you can make savings on activation, and you need to do more brand. Yeah, but it's different when you're doing online selling, isn't it? E-commerce, you don't need to do brand building for e-commerce. People will just go online and, you know, find it and buy it, and it's all very straightforward. Well, again, there's a little bit of truth there. In e-commerce, activation is easy. It's sales are a click away. So you can save money on the activation part of the budget, but you need to do the brand building. So for online brands, again, it's more like 75-25. Brand building is even more important than normal for online retailers. And this explains why Jeff Bezos has now said that he's fallen in love with TV advertising. And this is why Amazon is now one of the biggest TV advertisers in the UK. The last Christmas, the single biggest TV advertiser in the UK was Procter & Gamble. They have one or two brands, I don't know if you noticed. Second biggest was Amazon. Amazon spent £45 million on TV advertising in the UK alone last year. They're an online business and they realise now that the easy days of growth that they had in their early part of their career are over. If they want continued momentum, they need to harness the power of brand building and media like TV. Yeah, but there's another way of doing things, isn't there? Subscription. Everybody talks about fucking Dollar Shave Club, don't they? I mean, it's this is the new way of building brands, isn't it? You get people to sign up, you get their email address, you get them to log on and open an account, and then you've got them. You've got them forever. And everybody is piling into that model, and it's surprisingly how unprofitable it is. Nobody's ever shown me that Dollar Shave Club was actually very profitable, for instance. Okay, so subscription models do change some things, but what they mainly change is activation. You've got these people's names and addresses and email addresses, and therefore activating them, getting them to buy stuff now is easy, but the really hard job is bringing them in the first place, and that needs brand building, and so subscription businesses, again, need a higher ratio of brand to activation, more like 75-25. So, if you look at the way that the economy is going, we are moving in the direction of more innovation, more online research, more subscription selling, more e-commerce, and all of those mean the need for more brand building. So, if you look at the optimum balance between brand and activation over time, what you see is it's gradually been creeping up over time. Overall, across the whole of our sample, it's about 60-40, but the most recent years suggest it's closer to 75-25. And in fact, actually, the way we're now increasingly looking at this is rather than just saying it's a 60-40 rule for everyone, it's look at your category, look at the right mix for your category, and then look at how to adjust that based on things like your brand size, your price position, and so forth. So, yes, there are some variations in the rules, but very, very few brands are in a situation where they don't need to lead with brand building, and all brands need some brand building. So brand building is definitely not dead. But that's not the lesson that marketers have taken from all this. If you go back to about the year 2000, then this is UK data from Ender's analysis. Back in around about 2000, people were obeying the 60-40 rule. So the typical split was about 60% on brand building and about 40% on activation. But since then, there's been a radical shift towards activation. Nowadays, typically, in the UK at least, it's more like 50-50. And that is not efficient. And I only have data on this for the UK, but my guess is that this is happening in lots of other markets, and it's probably happening in your market too. What marketers are doing is they're seeing the efficiency of online activation, paid search, programmatic, and so forth, outbound emails, and they're going, that's the way forward. But that's the wrong lesson. The efficiency of online marketing means you can make savings in that area, but you still need to invest in brands. And as a result, what we're seeing is the potential effectiveness of all the glorious new media and communication tools that we have at our disposal are being compromised. Effectiveness has fallen over the last few years when it should have risen. We have better tools than ever for selling things and for making consumers want our brands, and yet we're getting smaller and smaller effects with them because we're misallocating our budgets and focusing too much on these small-scale activities that don't build brands. But there is a way out. I'll give you a very specific example. This is a company that we work with in London. This is the Automobile Association that got into precisely that trap. They used to be the best-loved brand in Britain. But this is a membership organisation that provides breakdown cover for when your car breaks down, amongst other things. And they've been around for about 100 years, very well loved. They used to be thought of as the fourth emergency service. So it was, you know, police, ambulance, fire brigade, and the AA. That was their strap line from their brand campaign. But then a few years ago, they just completely cut their brand advertising to zero. Massively slashed their communications budgets, just cut down to online activation. So outbound emails, paid search, price comparison sites, lots of price offers. So what they called, you know, hard-working performance marketing. Now, that had no wastage, highly efficient, high ROI. ROI is great, isn't it? That's the thing that you should be trying to maximize. No, it shouldn't. Because what was happening was all the brand metrics were falling. Awareness was falling. Preference was falling. People were forgetting about this company. They were no longer searching in Google for the AA. They were searching for breakdown cover. And that took them to price comparison sites, which meant they got themselves in a bidding war with other brands. Market share was in decline. Prices were falling. Margins were falling. And they were in this situation where they realized that their ROI from their communications had never been higher, and in about 5 or 6 years, they would be out of business. That's what happens if you try to maximize efficiency. That's what happens if you try to maximize ROI and you cut your budgets. You end up going out of business. So they had a turning point. They bought a book by some guys called Binet and Field. A very good book, actually, very reasonably priced. And they used two very simple rules to, first of all, set their budget so that their share of voice was back above their share of market, which is what you need to drive growth, and reallocate the budget 60-40 between brand and activation. And then the third smart thing they did was they came to us and they bought this ad. Okay, so that was very different from what they've been doing up until now. I mean, they've been spamming people with, 10% off and all, lots of price offers, but not giving them a reason to want to go to the AA in the first place. This got people talking about the AA. This got people sharing the video, sharing the music track, actually. And it got awareness back up. It got liking for the brand back up. It got people Googling AA, not breakdown cover. And that meant people went straight to the AA website and bought at premium prices rather than going through a price comparison site and getting into a bidding war. And that was nearly all TV. Bit of online video, but TV was the main driver of that. What we wanted to do was to reach the mass of people in Britain, reach as many drivers as possible, not just the handful that we had email addresses for. And that reversed a 5-year decline in market share in a single year, despite the fact that they were actually doing less discounting, which meant that margins improved radically. So that's what happens when you re-engage with brand building. It's not difficult. It's not rocket science. So what does that mean for media? Well, our research shows that brand building and activation require quite different approaches to media. If you want to do high performance marketing, you need tight targeting because you want to focus on the people most likely to respond right now. You need to give them relevant messages. These people are shopping, they're on a mission. You need to not waste their time, not entertain them, not charm them. You need to give them the information they need to make the decision and to close the deal. So performance marketing tends to be quite rational and quite information heavy, requires media that are information rich. And it needs to be responsive. You want to make it as easy as possible for people to buy. So ideally, you include a response mechanism. One-click ordering would be ideal. So TV doesn't quite fit that bill a lot of the time. You're looking at things like more digital media, which can be very information-rich and can have a one-click response. But if you want to do brand building, you need almost the complete opposite of that. You need to go very broad reach, because you're not just talking to people in the market now. You're talking to people in the market tomorrow, next week, next month, next year, 2 years' time. We know that brand advertising has effects that can last at least 3 years and often longer. So the effects are really long term, and therefore the media tend to be need to be really broad reach. And of course, there is no medium that has the reach and dwell time of TV, even in the digital age. Secondly, you need to hit people at the emotional level when you're doing brand building. You need emotion because you need people to pay attention when they're not interested in what you have to say. Emotion does that. You need to create long-term memories. People remember emotions long after they've forgotten facts and figures. And psychologists also tell us that emotions are really important for the reward mechanism that you use to train people to prefer one brand over another. So you want emotionally rich media, and video is the emotional medium par excellence. And finally, you need to do stuff that's memorable, and people remember things they've seen and things they've heard as well. Music is really, really important. So for all these reasons, we find that video formats work best for brand building, both for online and offline brand building. And you do need both online and offline video in today's world. I work for Adam and Eve, and it's in my contract I have to show one of these ads anytime I stand up on stage. So we do the advertising for John Lewis, which is the UK department store. Particularly, we do their Christmas advertising. And every Christmas, we produce a big blockbuster film like this one.
Come in!
All my little plans and schemes lost like some forgotten dream. Seems like all I really was doing was waiting for you. Just like little girls and boys playing with their little toys. Seems like all we really were doing was waiting for love. Don't need to be
Okay, so that's, I think, one of the best examples of pure emotional brand building. This is not about prices and products. I mean, you could buy the penguin in the store, but it's not an advert for penguins. It's about the emotions involved in giving and receiving presents. And this stuff is the most famous advertising in Britain. Every year, for us, the Christmas ads these days are like the Super Bowl in the UK. And people, we release these ads at 7:30 a.m. on the first morning of the campaign, and we release them online first. And people rush to be the first person to see the ads online. And the number of views we get are incredible. We do a little bit of online seeding, which is the stuff in blue, but by 2016, we were getting nearly 70 million views online, nearly all for free in the UK. 70 million views in a country of 60 million people. That's not a bad result. Until you compare it against the effectiveness of the TV. Later that evening, we go on primetime TV. And by that point, everybody is excited about seeing the ad on TV. The TV companies actually advertise which break the ad will be in. They tell us, you know, the John Lewis ad will be in the centre break of X Factor tonight. Don't miss it. I think we're actually using the ads to sell X Factor. Well, how many views do we get on TV? Well, as you know, nobody watches TV anymore. We get about 800 million views on TV. We're getting nearly a billion views in a country of 60 million people. You can see those online views are actually a small layer on the bottom now when you compare them to TV. The online is really useful. It gets people excited. It amplifies the effect of the TV. But TV is still the main driver for the most effective and most famous and most successful advertising campaign in Britain. And this is what smart marketing looks like in the digital age. TV and online working together. Total TV, as Rupen said. Now, we get people saying all the time, nobody watches TV anymore, mass media doesn't work anymore. Those John Lewis ads, every pound they spend on those TV ads generates £10 of extra profit. Not revenue, but profit. 10-to-1 profit ROI. So yes, TV does still work. And the ROI from those ads goes up every year. It was 8-to-1, then it was 10-to-1. I think the most recent one is about 11-to-1. And this is mirrored in the research that Peter and I have done with the IPA. What we find is that over time, the effects of all the main traditional broadcast media have gone up. What we see is, for example, in the old days, adding TV to the schedule increased the effectiveness of a campaign by 27%. Now, it increases effectiveness by 40%. Radio and outdoor have also increased in effectiveness, and there's even been a slight increase in the effectiveness of press advertising, which I think is remarkable given to what's happened to newspapers. And we're not the only people that say that. Ebiquity and Thinkbox and people like that have done research both in the UK and the US. And what we see is that the ROI from TV advertising is going up over time. But this can't be right, can it? Because there's a whole tranche of the most effective and profitable companies in the world don't do this stuff. You know, the Ubers and the Amazons, you can see where I'm going. They are all piling into TV advertising. This is data from the US showing TV advertising for Facebook, Amazon, Apple, Netflix, Google. You can see that over the last couple of years, they've doubled their spend on TV advertising in the US. We're seeing the same thing in the UK. We're seeing this all around the world. These companies have finally realized you do need to do advertising, you do need to do brand advertising, and if you're going to do brand advertising, you do need TV. So I think mass marketing is alive and well. I think it has possibly a brighter future because I think the pendulum is turning back. And TV still plays a massively important role in that world. Thank you.